BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
Ancient Hebrew scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His Word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the book of Bereshit Genesis. I did say last week that we were going to be doing a multiple of Parash number one, but I was like, no, I'm just going to keep moving on. But in the future, I am going to do a whole, maybe 1 year on the book of Genesis, like chapter by chapter. But for right now, I'm going to stay with the Parash because with so many wonderful things going at the congregation, I was like, that's going to be bad because I'm going to mess up something, and I don't want to mess up the Word of God, because that's the most wonderful honor that I have, of teaching my Father's Word. And I want to bring Him honor and respect that is due His wonderful kingdom. So I want to do it to the highest level. I know there's many rabbis and pastors out there that don't do Bible studies anymore, and all they want to do is come in and do their couple hours of preaching, but actually, The most enjoyable time I find is actually in our Road to Emmaus, in our Bible study. You know, I mean, Shabbat is wonderful, but, you know, seeing people like go like that, to, like God's Word, that's when people understand Him more, it makes Him happy and it makes me happy. Amen. So that's what I like doing. You know, I know many of my colleagues, oh, you like teaching Bible study? Yeah, because sometimes the basics are the best. You know, when you build a good foundation, you know, mechanics are the best of anything. If you don't have good mechanics in your sports, you're not going to be able to do anything well. So it's the same with the Word of God. Sometimes it is good to do the basics, and there's also the other part of me that likes to get really deep into the Word, into the gematria and everything else like that, and the mathematics and the patterns and the prophecy and all the other wonderful stuff. So here we're in message E271. Parash number two. This is called Noach. It is from chapter 6 of the book of Bereshit, or if you're Ashkenazi, Bereshit, chapter 6, verse 9 through chapter 11, verse 32. As we spoke about last week, what I am going to be doing, and I would like, you know, if you're listening in, to do the vocabulary words and email them in to info@bethgoyim.org. Okay, the vocabulary words. And you can download the Parash. I leave them up there for 7 weeks, the PowerPoint that our wonderful brother Ben is doing. And if you like them, give him a thumbs up. If you don't, give him a thumbs down. Okay? And the review words, which they're on the screen, correct? You put the review words? Thank you. Okay, review words for Bereshit 6 is the word history, generation, righteous, wholehearted, corrupt, violence, pitch, not as in baseball, pitch, establish, livestock, and creeping. So I'll do those again. History, generation, righteous, wholehearted, corrupt, violence, pitch, establish, livestock, and creeping. Okay, these are basic words, but sometimes you want to look up the biblical definition, you know, and that's what I highly suggest. Now, don't just think that you know it. Look it up in a Bible dictionary, just to so you really understand what the word means in the Hebrew. Hebrew is a wonderful, perfect language, and that is the only perfect language on the planet. Okay? Why do I say it's perfect? Because God gave us His commandments in Ivrit, in Hebrew. Let's now go to Genesis chapter 6, verse 9. Okay? Genesis chapter 6, Bereshit chapter 6, verse 9. Here is the history of Noach. In his generation, Noach was a man righteous and wholehearted. Noach walked with God. Amen? So we're focusing on the word wholehearted. That's the first. So you see the picture of the pie. I think that's pumpkin pie. You put a little ice cream with that, it's really very good. If it's not Shabbat, you can warm it up. Really excellent. Good pumpkin pie with a little cinnamon, you know, a little Cool Whip, you know, a little vanilla ice cream, and then, you know, Cool Whip on top. Really excellent. But in the picture, I chose that there were a picture where the pie had one piece taken out. One piece taken out. Okay? See, being wholehearted means that you don't have a piece taken out. See, for Shabbat, we had a beautiful, beautiful pie this evening, a blueberry pie. It was very good. And a little Ready Whip on top. And before, you know, it was, you know, I took a picture. You know, I didn't take a picture. I took a picture of the soda. Okay? And the pie was whole. Okay? Being wholehearted means to be complete in every aspect of what you're doing. And it's saying here, Noach was the only one in his generation who was righteous and wholehearted. That's a sad statement. And we know, you know, we've gone through this before, but, you know, just to further what we know, is that the Lord flooded, Yehovah flooded the earth after this. Now, it's sad that only one man and all the thousands and thousands and thousands of people that were on the earth, there was only one wholehearted. But God blessed. Now, there's a great lesson to be learned in this. If a man is wholehearted with his God, if he is married, then everyone else in his family will be blessed because of his walk with God. Because Jehovah made Adam the head of his household. Okay? Adam, the head of his household. And he was righteous, meaning, how could he be righteous? There was no Torah written. Well, Torah was in our heart, because remember, as we talked about last week, when Jehovah made Adam, and when Adam bit the fruit, he bit the fruit not from the tree of life, but from the tree of good, knowledge, the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And when Adam bit the fruit, he gained all knowledge. All wisdom came into him of both good and evil. Now that knowledge is in his DNA. It is in his bone marrow. The knowledge of Torah is in your bone marrow. It is in your DNA, as we'll go into that tomorrow in Hebrews 4, okay? In Hebrews 4, we're going to go into that, okay? So he's righteous and he's wholehearted. See, the more you take out of the pie, well, the pie is good and it goes into your tummy and it makes it fat like mine, okay? So the more you take out of the pie, the less pie that there is. In your walk with God, you don't want to take away any of the pie. You want all of the pie that God has for you. So the more that you have, the more that you will get. So Noach, it says here, look at verse 9 again. Here's the history of Noach. In his generation, Noach was a man righteous and wholehearted. Noach walked with God. Okay? So the more that you have of the word in your life, the more that you apply the mitzvot, the commandments, in your life, the more that you walk with God. The less you take out, the more that pie that disappears of God's word in your life, the less you walk with God, the less blessings you get. And it always comes down to that part. Remember the part in Scripture where the hand was writing on the wall and it said, many, many tekel ufarsim. Okay? You have been found waiting and wanting in the balance. When does that scale tip where you're no longer even walking on the path of God? Do you want to chance it? So look at the pie again. Okay, there's one piece. Now, is one piece going to make you not walk with God anymore? Maybe if it's a part that is an abomination before the Lord. Okay, so that can, there are pieces that are more powerful than other pieces of the law. Okay, because the law does have layers to it. Okay? So what's an abomination? Well, if a woman wears armor, okay? She's not to wear armor. She's not to wear a tallit. Okay? She's not to wear tzitzit. I know, you know, it's confusing because you see the Reformed Jews, these women who are carrying tallits, carrying Torahs and wearing tallits. It's an abomination, okay? They should not be. It is not their role to do that, okay? Can a woman have a Bible? Yes, but she can't wear a tallit. It is strictly for the men because it says, B'nai Yisrael. Anything that ends in a yod is strictly male-oriented, okay? So Noach, coming back to Noach, he was righteous and wholehearted, so we had a full pie. Now, with that understanding, hold your place in Genesis 6. We're going to now move to Hebrews 11. Hebrews 11, Messianic Hebrews 11, verse 7, please. Messianic Hebrews 11, verse 7. By trusting, Noach, after receiving divine warning about things yet unseen, was filled with holy fear and built an ark to save his household. Through this trusting, he put the world under condemnation and received the righteousness that comes from trusting. Amen? So here, the account of Noach even went into the Brit Hanashah. And in the book of Hebrews, I believe it's, I've said it was Rav Shaul, but the more I read it, and you look it through the history, and you see that Luke is a student of Shaul. Okay, you see that it's like sometimes Luke is writing, and sometimes Shaul is writing. Okay, so here, I believe that this is Paul either teaching Luke, or Luke quoting from his teacher, Shaul. Okay, so after receiving a divine warning, okay, what is this divine warning? Yehovah said that I'm going to flood the earth. Okay, now it took 100 years to build the ark, and it takes perseverance. That's why also Rav Shaul talks about running the race. And Yeshua says, till the end. That means you're not going to be raptured out. Till the end means you got to run the race. So receiving divine warning. Well, what is a divine warning? When God speaks and he says, do this, keep my mitzvot, okay, that's a divine warning. Okay, then it says here, he was filled with holy fear. Holy fear. That's what most New Testament followers do not have. They do not have holy fear. Well, what is holy fear? Understanding that if you break the commandments, if you're willfully breaking the commandments, that there's something, a chastisement that's going to happen to you. And then once again, we come to the balancing scale. So Noach was righteous and wholehearted. It says that he was able to save his whole household. This is how important teaching men the Torah and believing in Yeshua, who kept the Torah, this is how important it is for men, and that's why we have a men's ministry. Teaching to be wholehearted, teaching to be righteous, okay? So that you can be savers of your family, okay? By Noach's walk with the Lord, he saved Mrs. Noach. We don't know her name. I don't know why we don't know her name. That would have been nice to know her name. She's Mrs. Noach, okay? So, and he saved his sons, Shem, Ham, and Japhet, and the three daughters, okay? So he saved seven other people because of his walk with God, because of the divine warning. So we take that. Now, what is important with these teachings and why we do the Parash cycle each year is because you're supposed to build upon this building block. So Noach was told by a word by Yehovah, and he built upon it, and it saved himself and his whole family when the world was perishing. Now, if we take that to what's coming in the book of Revelation, then we too will save our households. So that's how important that our walk was with the Lord, okay? And it is a divine warning. We have the book of Revelation, which is a divine warning. All right, let's move on now. Let's go back to Bereshit, chapter 6 again. We're going to do a little bit of chapter 6. We're going to do a couple of different chapters. I'm going to try to keep these as an hour for the teaching so you can get it in 1 hour. Okay, with no commercial interruptions. Bereshit chapter 6, verse 11 and 12. The earth was corrupt before Elohim, and the earth was filled with violence. Elohim saw the earth and saw that it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. Amen? Now, in last week's Parash, if you're reading it, there's an interesting question that one should ask. It's an interesting question. Had Chava understood by talking to the beautiful jeweled angel, and when the angel started to question the Father's commandments, if she had just walked away from him, would we even be talking? Okay? Once the corruption begins, understand that, once the corruption begins, it permeates into everything. Okay? Once, you know, even like in the congregation, that's why we have the incense candles burning when people walk in and have a fan blowing the biblical medicine around. Okay? Why? Because if one person comes in and they're sick, they're corrupted. Sickness is a corruption. Okay? You're not at perfect stasis. Okay? So once that corruption begins, and that person, the corruption. Okay? So once the corruption begins, if we look at verse 11 and 12 again, the earth was corrupt before Elohim, and the earth was filled with violence. Once corruption begins, it then permeates into the rest of the world because the sickness just keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger, okay? In verse 12, now let's look at the word corrupt. The word corrupt in the Ivrit is shakath. The root word is shakath. Shin, chet, tav. Shin, chet, tav, shakath. It means to destroy, corrupt, go to ruin, decay, be marred, be spoiled, be injured, be ruined, be rotted, to spoil, to pervert. Okay? So here, everything had become perverted. Sounds a lot like our world today. Because why? Because people are saying we don't need God. We don't want to have the holy days. We don't want to follow the law. We're not under that law. So once you pervert what is perfect and you say that we don't need it, then you injure your spirit, you spoil your spirit, and then it becomes corrupt. And the longer you go without God's word, it becomes more corrupt, and this corruption led to the destruction of the world, except for the eight that were in the ark, okay? The ark, okay? The eight that were put in the ark, okay? So let's read 11 and 12 again. The earth was corrupt before Elohim, and the earth was filled with violence. Elohim saw the earth and saw that it was corrupt. All flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. Amen? See, when Chava bit the fruit, this began the corruption. She gave it to her husband, and then instead of him going and talking to his father and saying, Avinu, the lady you gave me, my wife, she did the bad thing. What do we do now? Okay? But he partook in the corruption, and then everything else, it said all flesh have been corrupted. So now the animals, because of the sin, because what did Yehovah say in last week's Parash? This ground is cursed because of you. The ground is cursed because of you. So all flesh became corrupted. Why? Because the animals eat the grass. Then we eat the animals, and all flesh has become corrupted. And it has gone further and further until today, where it has become majorly corrupted. Almost as bad as it was in these two verses. Now here, also in verse 12, it speaks of Elohim saw the earth and saw the corruption. He could see from Hashemayim that everything had become corrupted. So don't think that you can hide yourself from God. He knows all things. He can just look at you and go, psh, look at that. Psh, look at that. Psh, look at that. Okay? Psh, look, psh, 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 look at that. Okay? Psh, look at that. Okay? He's looking at that. He can just see the corruption. Okay? Now, with that understanding, hold your place. In Bereshit 6, turn over to Matthew 24, verse 37 to 39. Matthew 24, verse 37 through 39. For the Son of Man's coming will be just as it was in the days of Noah. Back then, before the flood, people went out eating and drinking, taking wives and becoming wives, right up until the day Noah entered the ark. They didn't know what was happening until the flood came and swept them all away. It'll be just like that when the Son of Man comes. Amen? Now, the rabbis write that, you know, that there was a lot of homosexuality going on. Is that possible? Yes, but you cannot prove it through Scripture, so don't believe it, unless you can point to a Scripture. Okay, because it says here, they were taking wives and becoming wives. Okay, so is that homosexual? It could be, but it doesn't necessarily mean it. There is no perfect Scripture to say, like in Leviticus 18:22, don't have sex with a man as you have with a woman. That's clear and cut and very precise. Okay, so I just want to make sure that everybody understands that the rabbis write, well, in Noach's time, you know, they were having homosexual sex. Possible, probable, yes, but I can't prove that from Scripture unless you give me a strict word that says, yes, that's what they were doing. But we do see in the days of Noach, we see a lot of governments and a lot of leaders are very, very, very corrupt. Okay? So here, people are stealing, people are lying, people are cheating, as we see, you know, and what's going on in the election process. They're trying to steal the election from Mr. Trump. And it is a very interesting thing. I did read something today where twice in American history, they did change the Electoral College, where people that won the Electoral College didn't get to be president. So they're trying to do that here. It's a corruption. They can't take that they lost, okay? Because they want to have their own ways, even though it was a process, and they're making up lies, because there's no set thing that there's lies that the Russians did it, okay? So here, look at verse 37 to 39 again. The Son of Man's coming will be just as it was in the days of Noah. Back then before the flood, people went on eating and drinking, taking wives and becoming wives, right up until the day Noah entered the ark. And they didn't know what was happening until the flood came and swept them all away. It will be just like that when the Son of Man comes. Amen? And Yeshua also says that in the Gospels too, it'll be like that. Why? Because of increased distance from the Torah. So he's referencing that. Increased distance from the Torah. The Torah is perfect. Noach saved his family because he was close with God. He walked with God. He was righteous and wholehearted. Nowadays, we have hardly anybody who is wholehearted with God or even trying to follow the commandments. Okay? So when Yeshua said that, you need the background of Bereshit 6. Speaking of Bereshit 6, let's go back there. Genesis 6, verse 17 and 18. Now, let's go back there. Bereshit 6, verse 17 and 18. Then I myself will bring the flood of water over the earth to destroy from under heaven every living thing that breathes. Everything on earth will be destroyed, but I will establish my covenant with you. You will come into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Amen? So there you see a picture of a person like with the breath of life coming out of him, all the colors. So it's like because everything that breathed was going to have the breath of life taken from it. And the reason is because they don't want to follow the commandments that were in their heart. Then in verse 17 it says, I myself will bring the flood. I'm going to do it myself because you've destroyed my earth. I'm going to bring punishment on you. Okay? Everything that breathes will be destroyed. Okay? Now, the other part that's interesting, once again, in verse 18, look at verse 18. But I will establish my covenant with you. You will come into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. Amen? So here, because one man, the head of his household, because of his responsibility to follow the king, his love of his God, his zealousness for the word, his steadfastness of his walk with the Lord was not only to saving himself, but the Lord said, you know what? Bring your wife, bring your kids, and even bring their wives. And I'm going to establish a covenant with you. That's how important our walk is with the Lord, especially for men. Not to say that women don't have a great role, because without women, hey, none of us are here. You know, there was only one birth by a man, and that was Adam, and he really didn't do it. The Lord took a rib out of him. Okay? So we need the ladies to bring forth children. So there's God equally loves the men and the women, so don't think I'm a male chauvinist. What I'm trying to point out is the role that is being taken away from him. When you see the fags and what they do, you know, I want to be a girl today. No, you're not supposed to be. You're supposed to be a man. You're supposed to be the protector of your family. You're supposed to be a man who fears God. You're supposed to be a lover of God, a lover of his word, a leader of his family in spirit and in truth. And that's what we don't have today. And in what we do here a lot in the Latin culture, we have a lot of women coming to the congregation. We have some men, but I'd love to see more men. Because men, well, that God stuff, you know, I want to stay home and watch soccer. I want to watch football. I want to watch baseball. I want to do this. I want to do anything else. I want to watch killing movies. But I don't want to learn the word of God. But look how important, look how important. Look at verse 18 again. But I will establish my covenant with you. You will come into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. So it's such a great blessing that if you persevere, gentlemen, if you persevere through trials. Now remember, it had never rained on the earth. Noach's building this ark for 100 years. I'm sure there were people saying some really bad things about him, calling him some really bad names. But since he persevered and he trusted in the word God gave him, he was blessed when everybody else was cursed. And not only him, that's another real important part, everybody. Not only him. And this is what a godly man's role is. What a godly man's role is you, your sons, and your wife will all be blessed, and there'll be provisions when there's hell happening around us. And we see in the book of Revelation, so much hell is coming. Now, maybe we get a little bit more time. Maybe this new president, if he ever gets in. You know, I mean, the Lord said, I will bless those who bless Israel. He says he's moving the embassy to Jerusalem. It's one of the first things he's going to do is move the United States of America's embassy to Israel's eternal. And he called it Israel's eternal capital. I mean, God's got to hear that. Okay? So maybe. Now, is he a righteous man? Does Donald Trump walk with God? I don't really think so, but he, you know, neither did Nebuchadnezzar, okay? Neither did, you know, Ahasuerus, you know? Remember Esther's king? He wasn't a follower of God, but he did bless Israel. He did bless Israel. He did let Nehemiah go back and build the walls, okay? So, what we're talking about here is a covenant. How important is a covenant with God? That's what we're talking about here in verse 18. A covenant with God is so important, it can not only just save you, but it can protect even those around you. Understand this concept, especially you men. How important this covenant with God is. Noach was walking with God when everybody else wasn't. So he saved his family because God honored the covenant that he made with his servant Noach. Now with that, when we're looking at breathing and that God's going to take away your breath or give you breath, hold your place there in Bereshit 6. And turn to the Gospel of Yochanan, chapter 20. John 20, verse 21 and 22. John 20, Shalom Alechem, Yeshua repeated. Just as the Father sent me, I myself am also sending you. Verse 22, having said this, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Ruach HaKodesh. Amen. This shows that he's one with the Father. The Lord breathed into Adam's nose and a breath of life came into him. The Lord can take our breath away with a plague or a flood. But then Yeshua breathes on his students and said, receive the Spirit. Receive life. Receive. Now, what is this breathing? What is this breathing that he's doing? Receiving a covenant. Receive. When the Ruach HaKodesh comes and he breathes on you, receiving a covenant. Now, nobody else can do this. I know there's freaks out there. Christian, you know, you have these Christian pastors. Don't ever, ever be part of something like that. That is demonic. It is not from God, because only Yeshua can do that. He is the Son of the Father. We are his servants. We can receive his breath of life, but only from him. Don't take it from a man, because you'll be taking a demon instead of the breath of life. Now, also, now let's turn to Revelation. Revelation 11, verse 10 through 12. Revelation 11, verse 10 through 12. Revelation 11. Hopefully you're learning something. Not doing all the verses like we tried to do last week. I'm picking the biggest parts. We're still in chapter 6 and I want to get this in 1 hour. Revelation 11, verse 10 through 12, please. The people living in the land rejoice over them. They celebrate and send each other's gift because these two prophets tormented them so. But after 3.5 days, a breath of life from Elohim entered them. They stood up on their feet and great fear fell on those who saw them. Then the two heard a loud voice from heaven saying to them, come up here. And they went up into heaven in a cloud while their enemies watched them. Amen. This is about the two prophets who for 3 years shut up the reins. And then people are like, oh man. And then finally, the Lord allows them to be overcome by the adversary. And they kill them, the two prophets, in Jerusalem. Now, what's so interesting about this passage? Now, this was written 2,000 years ago. And it says, when you read the rest of it, that the whole world watches them. And they send gifts to one another. Okay? Now, this is tying together with the Feast of Purim, okay, and Esther. So understand that. It's a prophetic memorial day. You need to understand that to understand this. But the other part why I'm saying this is what we're doing right now. Right now, let me just take a quick gander. Okay? On our Skype call right now, we have somebody in the Philippines and somebody in Alaska. Okay? This is the first time in history since 2,000 years ago that everybody in the world can watch Jerusalem. Right now, you can log in to the Kotel and see people at the Wailing Wall in Jerusalem. Now, this takes place in that area, okay? This is the first time in history that this can actually happen, that the whole world will watch them. Now, here, while we're doing it for the Parash, in verse 11, it says, after 3.5 days, the breath of life from God entered them. So you need to understand Noach, that God took the breath away. You need to understand Bereshit and Adam, he breathed into him. You need to understand the Gospel of Gospel of John, in 20, verse 22, how Yeshua breathed on them. So now, once again, these two people are dead for 3.5 days, it says. They had prophesied, everybody knew them. All the world was rejoicing because they hate God. They hate the law. They hate everything that these people were doing, these two that were doing. And who are they? We have no idea who they are. Okay? Have no idea who they are. And anybody says we know for sure who they are, they're lying. Because there are no names. There's no more information about these two prophets. You can only assume, and when you assume, you make an ass out of you and me. Okay? That's how you remember how to spell assume. Okay? It's a thing from The Odd Couple. Okay? So here, the breath of life came in. Now, why did the breath of life? Because they were righteous in God's sight. Now, going back, we're going back now to Genesis, Bereshit, chapter 6, verse 19. Bereshit 6, verse 19. This is a real good verse for today. Bereshit 6, verse 19. From every living thing, from everything living, from each kind of living being, you are to bring two into the ark to keep them alive with you. They are to be male and female. Amen. I know there's a lot of stupid snowflakes, the liberals out there. You can't put us into a box. If I want to be a girl today, I can be. Shut up, you moron. Okay. God's word is the best. Okay. And he said male and female. Now, if you're a seahorse, okay. You can be a girl and a boy, okay? Only if you're a seahorse. Is there any other animals? Let me know. I don't know of any other animals who are hermaphrodites that have both. But I know there's a seahorse. So if you want to be a seahorse today, go ahead. See how long you can hold your breath underwater. And then you can be a girl one moment and a boy in the next. But that is the only animal that I know of that can change its sex, okay? It is very clear here that it says male and female. I know that puts you into the box that you have to be one or the other. But you know what? That's the way God made you. So just live it, be it, and you know, live it and walk in it, okay? So it's very important to understand that there's male and female. Now, what's the difference between a male and a female? A female has ovaries, okay? A male, you can cut your piece off if you want. I think it's pretty stupid. You can even have a hole made, but you can never have ovaries. Okay? It's real simple. Only girls get ovaries. Get all those tiny little eggs. It's amazing that a little girl baby, my little granddaughter that was born, I guess almost 2 years ago. You know, she's a big girl now. Okay? But when she was born, she was about yo big. Inside of her was every child that she might have. Inside of Miha over there is every child that might be born to her, but they were already in her when she was born. That's what makes a female. I know you freaks out there have a problem with this, but you know what? I really don't care if your feelings got hurt. I really care about God. And if you don't like it, turn this off. And if you want to come here, don't worry. There's a baseball bat with your name on it. Okay? And don't think that I'm playing. And there's a few rocks in there. And my shoulder's hurting a little bit, but I think I could get it up around 70. You know? Okay? So don't worry. We stand for the word of God here. And if you've got a problem with that, I really don't care. I care about my Father in heaven and his word. So we said male and female because he made us that way. And each is beautiful in its design. A male is beautiful in his design. Okay, what God has for a male. A woman is beautiful in her design. And he made them with different parts. Isn't it amazing that instantaneously, when a baby is born, a mother starts producing milk? And if you think that we've evolved, you've got to be smoking some serious crack. Amazing. Instantaneously. 5 minutes ago, she was in labor. She was not lactating. As soon as the baby is born, she begins to produce milk. That's another thing you guys can't do. You can want to be a girl all you want. You're not going to be able to produce milk at least. You can have boobs because, you know, some of us who get fat, you know, they start hanging. Okay? It might look like you got a lady's breast, but nope, you're not going to have it. Nope. Okay, now what's important about that? Now, in the B'rit Hadashah, they say, you know, Jesus is all love. Well, let's see if he is. Mark chapter 10, please. Mark chapter 10, verse 6 through 8. I'm just talking about the Word of God here. Just talking. Mark chapter 10, verse 6 through 8. However, at the beginning of creation, God made them male and female. For this reason, man should leave his father and mother and be united with his wife. And the two are to become one flesh. Thus, they are no longer two but one. Amen? Look, they're talking about sex in the Bible. Yes, they're talking about sex in the Bible. Two shall become one flesh. One has one part. One has the other part. And God had it so that when he leaves his father and mother, that means he gets married, not fornication, not adultery, okay? And at the beginning, what does it say in the Brit Hadashah in the New Testament? Hey, he made them, you know, when he had the Garden of Eden, he made Adam and Steve, right? Steve and Adam, Bob and Mark, no. Mary and Michelle, no. Well, Adam felt like a girl one day, so it became Chava, and Chava became Adam, no. Okay, male and female. All right, we're done for a moment talking about this. All right, move back to chapter 7. This is an awesome picture. Genesis chapter 7. I want you to stare at the picture, and if you don't got the picture, download the PowerPoint. Okay, it's going to be up there for 7 weeks after that. If it's not up there, if you're listening to this teaching past the 7 week mark, no, that's the wrong one. Genesis 7, verse 6. Okay? 7, verse 6. Okay? And if it's not up there, send me an email at info@bethgoyim.org or rabbiandrew@bethgoyim.org. Noach was 600 years old when the waters flooded the earth. I think this is a fantastic drawing. Now, what most people don't consider is how far their sin touches other things. Had Chava just understood by talking to the adversary, Satan, that all these people would become corrupted. Look at the one guy, you know, he's like reaching up. Maybe he's standing on a rock and he's like reaching up like, what do I do? I don't know how to swim because it's never rained. Okay? You see the other man clinging to a rock. And you see the other couple, you know, hanging on something that might be floating. And all the while, the ones that were righteous are in the ark, and God has protected them. Imagine for a moment that you know by your sin what it's going to affect to your third and fourth generation. Would you do that sin? Look at these people in this picture. You got the bird. Even the bird is going to die because the bird's not going to have anything to eat after a while. Okay? Bird's not going to have anything to eat after a while. The man is like, look at how scared his face is. The artist who did this cartoon drawing really, really understood. Really understood the fear. Shh. Really understood the fear. And when the Lord flooded it, people are repentive then. People are repentive then. We should repent now and be wholehearted. Then this doesn't have to happen. Maybe it won't happen. No, it will. One way or another, you're going to meet God. And while you're falling from heaven all the way down to hell, there's no time to be repentive then. So you see the man, he's in the picture there, he's holding onto the rock, he's grasping for his life. Now the water's going to keep rising, and it's going to keep going to 22 feet above the highest mountain on the earth. Now, I've been in the Himalayas when I was in India. Boy, and I flew over the other parts of the Himalayas. Those mountains are tall. I haven't seen Everest, but those are some tall mountains. So imagine you're floating. You're trying to float. You know, you're floating. Maybe you knew how to float. How long can you float? You know, you're seeing all these people and these dead bodies floating around you. How long can you stay alive? So here comes the chastisement, because the whole earth had become corrupted. Everything, and the more that they study the earth and they find things, the more that this flood did occur. And it happened rapidly. There was something, I think, in China that it has found. And it could only have been done by a flood. A huge flood. Okay? So that picture is extraordinary. Now, understand that your sin, it will catch up to you. So God says, be wholehearted with him. Going on to the next part, we're now moving on to chapter 7, verse 11 and 12. 11 and 12. On the 17th day of the second month of the 600th year of Noach's life, all the fountains of the great deep were broken up, and the windows of the sky were opened. It rained on the earth 40 days and 40 nights. Amen? It's very interesting around the globe that you have all these sinkholes opening up. And a lot of them are opening up where there are lakes. What is the Lord doing? Is he replacing the water? Because you see here, the fountains of the great deep broke up. Remember, as we read last week in last week's Parash, in Parash number one, the earth was watered from below. Water came up through the earth. Okay? So now the Lord's putting the water back in. It's very interesting what's going on. So on the 17th day of the second month, that's when we're counting the Omer now. Between Bikurim and Shavuot, you got the second month. It's a very interesting time to maybe stop and pause in the 17th day of the second month and reflect on that day. It's very, you know, the Lord has it here for a reason. The 17th day of the second month, not February. That is a pagan name and a pagan month. Now, you have a lot of weirdies that don't know the scriptures, okay, that are in the 10th month instead of the 9th month. And they celebrated Pesach a month too early because they don't know the signs. In last week's parash, what we were talking about. The sun, the moon, and the stars are there for seasons, okay, and dates, okay? So here, you need to look at the stars to know when the second month is. And it's really a good time, I think, to reflect on God's goodness, his mercy. It's a time to reflect, to say, you know what? Maybe I need to rededicate my life. It's almost like Hanukkah. And yes, we celebrate Hanukkah. Why? Is it a Moedim? No, it's not a Moedim. Why are you celebrating it? Because Yeshua did in John 10:22. And I follow Yeshua. And if it was good enough for the Son of God to do it, it's good enough for me. It's about dedication. It's not about 8 days of oil. So the same thing in the 17th day of the second month, one might want to consider their lives. Because God began to destroy the earth in a 40-day period during that time. So maybe it's there for a very prophetic reason. 10 and 7. That's how you do the Hebrew. 10 plus 7. So you got 10 is the hand of God, 7 the perfection. The 17th day, 2nd is for the Father and the Son. Okay? Now we look at verse 16, Bereshit 7, verse 16. Those that entered went in, male and female, from every kind of living being, and Elohim had ordered him, and Yehovah shut him in. Okay, amen? So how was Noah going to close this door? He didn't have to. Dad shut the door. Okay, Dad, now, when you say, well, who shut Noah into the ark? How did he close that gigantic door? It says right there in verse 16, Yehovah shut him in. Okay, another big part about verse 16 is, once again, male and female. I know what in the news stories I'm bringing tomorrow, I think in the United Kingdom, they want people to stop in Oxford University. Oxford was supposed to be people with brains. It's supposed to be a good school. Now it's become a dumb school. It's worse than a community college. Okay? They're supposed to be one of the most prestigious schools on the planet, and they can't understand who's a boy and a girl. But God said, when he brought the animals in, male and female. Why? Because the male has one part. And he didn't bring any seahorses in. No seahorses were brought into the ark. No, not one seahorse. He swam. Okay? Now, that's important to understand. Hold your place in Genesis 7. And go to Matthew 25. Matthew 25. Verse 10 through 13. Now imagine, well, let's read it, and then I'll come to why we're reading it. Matthew 25, verse 10 through 13. But as they were going off to buy, the bridegroom came. Those who were ready went with him to the wedding feast, and the door was shut. Later, the other bridesmaid came. Sir, sir, they cried, let us in. But he answered, indeed, I tell you, I don't know you. So stay alert, because you know neither the day nor the hour. Amen? Now, had the people in the flood known what time the flood was going to begin, maybe they would have been repentant. Hey, Noah, I love God too. You know, I want to. Can you ask God to forgive me? You know, maybe. But now the doors close, and it begins to rain. People are probably like, "Hey, what's this? Hey, this is cool." But then, when the water starts getting up to your feet, and the water starts hitting your knees, and you know it's starting to come, you know, it's starting to rush around, and you're like trying to hold on to something. You see your bed floating down the road there. You see your house floating down the road. Okay. See, it's the same with the Lord here in Matthew 25. This is the 10 bridesmaids. Five are smart and five are morons. It says moros in the Greek, okay? Now they want to repent. You know, hell is happening on the earth. The Holocaust was happening. You know, when they were getting taken away on the cattle cars, I bet there was a lot of repentance going on. But God says, I turn my back on you. I turn my back. So the time is now before the flood starts happening, before the wars start happening, before, you know, your life can be gone like that. My dad was walking out of the store. He fell, boom, dead. CPR was started immediately. With inside of 1 minute, CPR was started. He was dead. You don't know when your time's up. But here, the bride, let us in, sir. Let us in, let us in. And what does the guy say? I don't know you. Same as what the Lord is going to say. I don't know you. I'm sure there were people banging on the ark. Noah, come on, Noah, let me in, let me in. You know, Lala, Noah probably was like, Lala, you know, make the cows moo or something. Moo, moo, make the elephant. Broo, broo. You know, somebody tickle the elephant so he makes a lot of noise. And so, but imagine that. But people will be banging on your door when the time comes. Do you let them in? Did Noah let them in? Something to think about. Right now. Something to think about right now. Do you let the unrighteous... See, when hell is happening, when hell is happening, there's going to be repentance. Of course there is. But as soon as hell stops, they're going to go right back to where they were. Yes, some may stay. But I'm sure there were people banging on the ark. Did Noah let any of them in? No. Going back to chapter 8 of Genesis, chapter 8 of Genesis, we have more review words. I forgot the review words for 7. Review words for chapter 8, Bereshi, fountains of the deep, restrained, raven, dove, surfish, freshly plucked, swarm, be fruitful, multiply, according to sweet aroma, curse the ground, humankind or mankind, imagings, exist, sowing time, ceased. These are words that you should look up and fully understand biblically. Now we go to chapter 8, verse 6 and 7. Chapter 8, Bereshit 8, verse 6 and 7. After 40 days, Noah opened the window of the ark, which he had built. And he sent out a raven, which flew back and forth until the water had dried up from the earth. Amen? In verse 6, there's a joke. Do you see the joke? Do you see the joke? BDM? Do you see the joke in verse 6? After 40 days, Noah opened the window of the ark, which he had built. Amen? What's the joke there, everybody? Well, there's a lot of animals in that ark. No windows. Could you imagine the smell? Imagine when he opened the window. Okay, you know, there are some fun things in the scriptures if you just wait a minute. You know, did you ever go to the circus? You know, I remember taking my kids to the circus. They used to have the guy with the gigantic shovel. You'd have the elephants in the middle of the circus, having a big thing come out of their behind over there. And the guy would bring this gigantic garbage can and a shovel that had a front on it like this big. Imagine the smell. Could you imagine going up there? Can I open the window yet, Lord? No, another 10 more days. You sure? Are you really? Because remember, the ark is pitched with pitch on the inside and outside. There was no way to let out any water. So imagine, oh my goodness, golly gee willikers, oh my, imagine the smell that was going on. Imagine, but, the smell, got, you grow with it. But imagine once you open the window, now you know what the smell is like out there. But now you're like, oh man, can you open up some more? Okay, now, in verse 7, look at the picture there. He sent out a raven which flew back and forth until the water had dried up from the earth. Now, what I want you to notice, the raven is an unclean animal. How do you tell that he's an unclean animal? Well, he's black. No, he's beautiful black. How do you tell? Well, he's dirty. No, it's just... Look at the end of his beak. Any bird that has a hook on the end of his beak like that is generally an unclean bird because the beak is used for ripping flesh. God has made this particular animal to be able to eat flesh, okay? The ravens eat, flesh of dead things. They catch mice and they catch rodents and things of that nature, okay? So any time you see a bird... This is also when we move further into Vayikra, Leviticus chapter 11, it says of these unclean birds. So if you don't remember the list of the birds, characteristics that you look for is the hook. And the hook is generally used for ripping things. Birds that eat seeds usually have a straight beak because they use that beak to burrow in to a seed and break it apart. Okay, they use a straight beak. The hook beak is more for ripping open things, okay? So he sends out a raven, and the raven flew back and forth, and he didn't find anything. Everything had rotted. It had sunk to the bottom of the ocean. After a while, even the dead bodies will then begin to sink into the ocean because it becomes waterlogged. The air comes out of it, and the birds eat those up, and then once... So the birds didn't have any place to sit, so they were probably eating the dead bodies, and once the body gets enough water in it, it will sink into the deeps of the ocean. Okay? So that's why he sent out a raven thing first. He's going to see if there's anything dead out there, because he can't touch a dead thing. Okay? Now we go back to verse 8 through 11. 8 through 11 now. Then he sent out a dove to see if the water had gone from the surface of the ground. But the dove found no place for her feet to rest. So she returned to him in the ark, because the water still covered the whole earth. He put out his hand and took her into him in the ark. He waited another 7 days, again sent the dove out from the ark. The dove came in to him in the evening, and there in her mouth was a freshly plucked olive leaf. So Noah knew that the water had cleared from the earth. Okay, now this picture is not very good. Because I don't believe that Noah was on the deck of the ark, okay? So here he set out his hand, and the dove brought a freshly plucked olive leaf, okay? Now the dove is very important because the dove is a clean animal. The dove eats seeds. Now, it rained 40 days, the whole earth was flooded. Yes, remember, God can make a tree in one day, okay? He did that before, he could do it again. And he flooded the earth, and he's had the water now come down. Now the dove of peace, the dove of a clean animal, the dove is white, generally, okay? The water had gone from the surface of the ground. But the dove found no place to rest. So she plucked the leaf, and she returned to the ark because the water still covered the whole earth, okay? But she did find the one leaf, and Noah knew that the earth would be clean. Now, what's so important about the dove? Hold your place there. Turn to Mark 1, please. Mark 1, verse 10 and 11. Mark 1, verse 10 and 11. Immediately upon coming up out of the water, he saw heaven torn open, and the Spirit descending upon him like a dove. The voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. I am well pleased with you." Amen. The dove represents a new life, a new beginning. The dove was sent out, and the dove brought back something living to Noach. So here the dove coming upon Yeshua, when he came up out of the water, represents a new beginning, a new start of something. And why did Noach come back to Noach the dove? Because he was righteous. Okay? The dove coming upon Yeshua, the Spirit descending upon him like a dove, represents the righteousness coming upon the Son of God. And the Lord said from heaven, "You are my Son, whom I love. I am well pleased with you." It's the beginning of his ministry, that he would then bring salvation to the world. Now we go to chapter 9. A few more minutes here, a few more minutes. Chapter 9. Bereshit chapter 9. We have some review words for Bereshit. 9, dread, population, handed over to, certainly, demand, and accounting, demand, sheds, image, herewith, establishing, everlasting, shamefully exposed. Interesting words that one should look up, but look them up in the biblical references. Bereshit 9, verse 1 through 4. 1 through 4. Elohim blessed Noach and his sons and said to them, "Be fruitful, multiply, and fill the earth. The fear and dread of you will be upon every wild animal, every bird in the air, every creature populating the ground, and all the fish in the sea. They have been handed over to you. Every moving thing that lives will be food for you, just as I gave you the green plants before, so now I give you everything. Only flesh with its life, which it is its blood, you are not to eat." Amen? That's a funky looking creature there. Okay? It's a really funny looking picture. Okay? Now, here, the earth has become corrupted. Now, in the garden, we did not eat animals. Okay? We only ate fruits and vegetables. Okay? So now, because of the corruption, we now need to eat the animals, because the animals are able to eat the grass. And we need the chlorophyll that's found in grass. But we can't eat grass or we'll get sick and die. Okay? So the Lord made the cow, so now we have to eat the cow. So people say, "Well, I'm a vegetarian." Well, you're not going to live a very good life, because God hated us so much, he said, "Eat animals." No, because our bodies require those nutrients that are found in the animals that we can't get. "Well, I'll just take vitamins." Vitamins don't work because your body's not designed that way. Most of the vitamins that you eat, you put them in your body, in your stomach. Your stomach acid destroys them. Look it up. Do some research. Because it's got to get into your intestines. Your stomach destroys the food, and it breaks it down, and then it puts it in the intestines. It's in your intestines. It's where you get your nutrients in your intestines. That's why you need to drink a lot of water. Because if you're dehydrated, you don't absorb stuff. You won't absorb medicines. Everything's absorbed in your intestinal area. The stomach is there to break things down, okay? So you're putting the vitamins in, but you're supposed to be eating the cow to get the vitamins from the dead cow. And I ate cow tonight, and boy, it was good. It was on sale. Okay, going on to the next part. Now, verse 5, Bereshit 9, verse 5. This is a very important part, so listen up carefully. We've got a few more minutes. "I will certainly demand an accounting for the blood of your lives. I will demand it from every animal, from every human being. I will demand it from every human being, an accounting for life of his fellow human being." Amen? So here, verse 5, it's very important to realize that animals have souls. So if an animal attacks a human, okay, they are breaking the commandments of God. Because why can you prove that there is a soul here? How can God demand an accounting for the blood of your lives? Or demand it from every animal? How can he demand it from an animal if an animal doesn't know? Okay? So if you have a pet dog, Okay, remember that dog has a soul. Okay, got a pet monkey? I don't know if you can have them, but if you do, hey, that's cool. Okay, every animal has a soul. God is going to demand an account of your life from you and from the animal. Okay? Okay, now let's go to Matthew 12, verse 36. Matthew 12, verse 36. Matthew 12, verse 36. Just fixing something here. Matthew 12, verse 36. Moreover, I tell you this, on the day of judgment, people will have to give an account of every careless word they have spoken. Amen? Once you understand Bereshit 9, that God is going to demand an accounting. Elohim is going to demand an accounting from every animal and from every human. So now Yeshua is saying in Matthew 12, verse 36, on judgment day, every careless word, everything you did, Lash and Hara, all the other silly stuff, going to get you kicked out of heaven. Okay? Because God's going to demand an accounting. Now finally, I believe this is the last one we're going to, Bereshit, go back to Bereshit 9, verse 12 through 16. Bereshit 9, verse 16. This one is 12 to 16. 12 to 16, Bereshit 9, 12 to 16, verses 12 to 16. This is very important that it's our sign and not some freak's sign. Just because somebody stole it doesn't mean it's theirs. Elohim added, here's a sign of the covenant I'm making between myself and you. Every living creature with you, for all your generations to come, I'm putting my rainbow in the cloud. It will be there as a sign of the covenant between myself and the earth. Whenever I bring clouds over the earth and the rainbow is seen in the cloud, I will remember my covenant, which is between myself and you and every living creature of every kind, any kind. And the water will never again become a flood to destroy all living beings. The rainbow will be in the cloud so that when I look at it, I will remember the everlasting covenant between Elohim and every living creature of every kind on the earth. Amen? I think it is fascinating that the homos are using this as their flag because it's totally against what everything they stand for. God, it's God's covenant. And when you break God's covenant, disaster comes. So God is using the people that are most against God's word and the homosexuals, okay, to tell the rest of the world that God keeps his covenant. Just because they use it doesn't really mean it's theirs. It's God is using them as a tool to let everybody else know that, yes, I chastise the whole world because they weren't following my covenant. And my rainbow is going to be that reminder that when you do bad, when it gets to a stink level up to heaven, I'm going to see the stink and I'm going to let Revelation, the book of Revelation, open up. Now finally, it's about a covenant. In verse 15, we're talking about a covenant between myself, that God's rainbow is a covenant. Finally, let's turn to our last scripture, Hebrews 10, verse 16. Hebrews 10, verse 16, final scripture. Hebrews 10, verse 16, this is the covenant which I will make with them after those days, says Jehovah. I will put my Torah on their hearts and write it on their minds. Hebrews 10, verse 16, this is the covenant which I will make with them after those days, says Jehovah. I will put my Torah on their hearts and write it on their minds. The rainbow is being put all around the world by those who hate God and hate his word, who live lives that are abominations before him. But what God is using them for is the rest of the people to say, this is my covenant, my Torah. My son followed it. He kept it. And so should you. I'm going to write it on your minds. You're going to see it. I'm going to put it in the sky so everybody can see it. I'm going to put it up on flags all around so you can see it. I'm going to write it in your mind. It's going to be part of your DNA. It's going to be so much into your bone marrow because God looks at everything. He's looking at us today. He keeps his covenant. The question is, do you? I bid you an amen and an amen. Amen.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about Him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift His face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you His shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend a day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into His eternal word. Not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of His kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to Him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.